Our first scripture reading is the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me down the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And our gospel reading today is found in the Gospel of John, the 9th chapter, beginning with verse 35. Jesus heard that they had put him out, meaning the man who had been born blind that Jesus had healed. And finding him, Jesus said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "Who is he, Lord, that I might believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have both seen him, and he is the one who is talking with you." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, so that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind." Those of the Pharisees who were with him heard these things and said to him, "We are not blind too, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But since you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word. This amazing encounter is part of what the New Testament scholars call the festival cycle, found in John 5 through 9, where Jesus goes to Jerusalem for festivals and feasts. John 5, 1 says, "After these things, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem." These stories start with a miracle, the healing of the paralytic by the pool at Bethesda. And they end with the miracle, the healing of the man born blind in John chapter 9. Thus, it was in the fall of the year, at the time of the Festival of Booths, the last of these series of feasts that Jesus attends, that he has this encounter with the man who is born blind. In the midst of these stories, there's growing and intense conflict with the scribes and the Pharisees. At one point, it's so intense, Jesus has to disappear into the crowds in the temple. But he cannot stay hidden. And why is that? Because there are people in need, people in crisis. There were people who needed to see him, just as there are today people who need to see him. We need to see him. We need to see him as he is, as Savior and Lord, especially in this time of crisis. Because of the crisis of the coronavirus, we're taping this message on a Saturday morning for you to be able to watch through YouTube on Sunday or whenever is convenient for you. As a nation, as a world, we are experiencing the crisis of a pandemic, an epidemic of an illness that is worldwide. The first believed case of COVID-19 was in Wuhan, China, on November 17, 2019. From that one case, there are, as of Friday of this week, 286,665 cases worldwide, with over 15,000 in the United States, and as of Friday morning, 80 cases in the state of Mississippi. In 4 months, it went from one case to almost 300,000 cases in 186 countries. In less than a month, we went from no cases in Mississippi to 80. It is the rapid spread of this disease that's part of the crisis. But the real dangerous part of this pandemic is the mortality rate, the number of deaths. The World Health Organization reports nearly 12,000 deaths worldwide. That is a mortality rate of 3.4%. For comparison, historically, the flu virus has a mortality rate of 0.001%. Thus, this is indeed a crisis. And like any crisis, it tests us. It causes you to change your focus, to turn your attention to other things, things that matter the most. You remember 9/11? All of us turned our attention away from trivial matters and even agendas that we felt were important to narrow our focus to what really mattered in the moment of the crisis. Even members of Congress, both parties, laid aside their political agendas and gathered on the steps of the Capitol and sang, "God Bless America." Life changed, but we quickly moved to a new normal. 9/11 not only changed life as we know it, it also challenged our faith. In the moment of that crisis, we all had to decide, do we really believe what we say we believe? In the same way, this crisis, this pandemic, COVID-19, is changing life. We're seeking to find a new normal, and I hope preaching to an empty building is not that new normal. Our faith, though, is also challenged. Do you still believe? In the face of this pandemic, do you still believe what you said you believed about God before this pandemic? Do you still believe in Him and what you believed about prayer? I had a pastor friend call me, and he had a question that he wanted me to answer. He said, if we truly believed in God and in the power of prayer, we should not fear this coronavirus, and we should gather as normal for worship, trusting God to protect us. Do we really believe what we say we believe? Well, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. And on the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Universal Church. I believe in the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and I believe in life everlasting. That is the Apostles' Creed, and I believe. This pandemic has not changed what I believe. So you might ask, like this pastor did of me, why shouldn't we gather and pray and trust God to protect us from the infection? That's because I believe in the Bible. And nowhere does the Bible say that faith and prayer will alter biological realities. However, the Bible does say in Matthew 5:41, He causes His sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. In other words, life happens, and it happens to all of us indiscriminately, regardless of race, nationality, or faith. God doesn't promise to shield us from the ugly realities of life, but He does promise to be with us, and He promises to bring good even from bad things. Romans 8:28 says, "For we know God causes all things to work together for good for them that love Him, for them who are called according to His purposes." This is what God promises, and I believe. Thus, if a crisis falls on me alone, or if it falls on all of us as a whole, it does not change my belief in God. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He has not changed, and I shall not change my faith in Him. Thus, for the good of my health, for the good of my family's health, for the good of my neighbor's health, I'm going to take the precautions that are recommended, including not having church as usual. That's why I'm preaching to you today in an empty sanctuary. I want to go and see my newest grandbaby in Louisiana, but for all of our sakes, we are quarantined in our house, and so must you be for the sake of all. Yet God is still sovereign. He's still in control. I can still trust in Him. I believe. What good is coming from this pandemic? Well, there are several goods I would point out. As a church, we have been reminded in a concrete way that church is not a building. It's a people. Having a building is nice, but it's not required. We've learned that worship does not have to happen on a particular piece of property at a particular time. It can be anywhere as long as you are connected with other believers. He will be there in your midst. We've learned that people are getting a break from what is for some a grueling schedule and routine. It's a gift, a period of unexpected rest. Families are spending time together. They're not going out to town. They're not going out to movies, but they're being home all together around the table. And we're being confronted with the question, do you really believe what you say you believe? A crisis does not cause faulty faith, but a crisis reveals it. Just as a crisis generally does not cause financial problems, a crisis reveals financial problems. And a crisis does not generally cause relationship problems, but it does reveal them. So, what is this crisis revealing in you? Do you believe that God can and will use all things, even a pandemic, to bring something good in your life? Can He, will He use this crisis to bring something good for your family? I believe. Do you believe? That's the question Jesus asked of the man born blind, the question that he was forced to confront. There's some things about this story that I would point out to you. The blind man did not see Jesus. He was blind. Nor did he seek Jesus. Jesus saw him. Jesus found him. Not once, but twice. Here's this one individual who has never seen the face of his parents or his friends. He has never seen the beauty of a sunrise or the delight of a rosebud opening. Born blind, the text tells us. Jesus was simply passing by at the Feast of Booths. He saw this man born blind and he healed him. He spat on the ground and he made a clay with his hands and he put it on the man's eyes and told him to go to another pool and to wash. He was healed. He could see. Life changed for him from darkness to light. Friends and neighbors saw him and they were astonished. How did this happen? Who healed you? They asked. The man formerly blind said it was a man named Jesus, but he had never seen Jesus, so he really did not know what he looked like, where he was. The healed man was brought before the Pharisees. It was the Sabbath and work was forbidden. And they questioned him thoroughly. They demanded to know what happened to him and who did it. So the formerly blind man told them that it was a man named Jesus and declared he was a prophet from God. Now, the Pharisees didn't like that. They called the man's parents in to confirm that this man had been born blind, and the parents confirmed it. They asked the parents to describe how this happened, and the parents said, "He's of age, ask him." So they questioned him again, and they warned him to not give glory to this man, Jesus, who was most certainly a sinner because he had healed on the Sabbath. The formerly blind man was amazingly blunt. He said, "This is amazing. This man opened my eyes, and you don't know that he is from God? Only God could do this," he said. Well, they didn't like that. They threatened him, and they sent him away. This is where our text picks up. Jesus heard how he had been treated by the Pharisees. And so Jesus finds the man a second time. It's astonishing to think about. Jesus found him the first time and healed him. And now Jesus finds him the second time with this new crisis in his life. Jesus looked for him and asked him when he found him, "Do you believe?" This man had been in crisis since birth, born blind. Jesus healed him. But the healing that Jesus brought to him brought the man to a new crisis, a crisis of faith. Now that he could see, Jesus, would he believe? The blind man said, "Lord, I believe, and so should you, and so should I. I believe that even in the midst of a worldwide pandemic, he is still Lord, and that he will be and is with us as we traverse this ground together, as we seek to establish what will be a new normal. He is with you. Do you believe?" Would you bow with me as we pray? Gracious Father, we thank you for this message of hope from your word. The man born blind who's now given sight, and may we also be given the sight to see that you are Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.